Welcome to Caravan Daily. You are watching our special show in which we talk to youths who are working through social media to make the people aware, and their work is remarkable in terms of making the people aware about the contemporary issues and talk on television media or on the videos. Here with us, Mr. Wali Rehmani, who is a law student, and he's just 19 years old, and for over last over 1 year, he has been making videos and quite popular on YouTube and Facebook, and has much following on the social media. Thank you very much, Wali Rehmani, to talk with us in this show. First, we would like to know when and why did you think that you should make videos on social media?
First, thank you so much, Caravan Daily, and especially Abbas, you, for acknowledging my work and acknowledging the fact that I have been striving in educating people and making people aware for the past 1 year. You asked me when and how did I start off with this journey. I had never thought that I would come into this activism life and I would do such kind of work where I would speak against the particular government or the present government, and I would try and expose them and make people aware of the historical facts and fight for the rights of people and fight against fake news. I had never ever thought that I would come into this field. But it was March 2017 when Yogi Adityanath became the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, the largest state of our country. And when this man became the Chief Minister, I was giving my board examination, class 12 board examination then. And as an 18-year-old boy, I was so agitated and frustrated about the fact that this man, a Yogi Baba, can even become the Chief Minister of a particular state. And I do not have to mention, I did not mention his body of work and the kind of hate speeches that he spread and the venom that he's been spewing against communities for the past so many years. I did not mention his speech, but people are aware of it, what he has been doing. If a man of that stature can become a Chief Minister of India's largest state, then where is our country heading towards? What is our education doing? Of what use is our education? I asked the question and I made a live video. I was only in class 12 then, and I made a live video.
On YouTube?
On Facebook.
Okay.
And a lot of anti-establishment pages took that video of mine and posted it. A lot of local websites took a video of mine and posted it. And I had no idea that overnight the video would reach a million people. And this video of mine was a life-changing event of mine, where I understood that this is the path that I have to work on. Accidentally, I came into this field, but now it is no more an accident. I am here by choice, and I will continue and pursue my work till the end of my life, till the last breath of my life, irrespective of everything, the threats that I get, irrespective of anything.
The important issues you are focusing on through your videos.
Okay, a very pertinent question that you asked me. So I have made around 50-60 videos around, and when I started off making videos, I am a Muslim man, so at the end of the day, you cannot run away from that identity. And you also cannot deny the fact that the Muslim Dalits and the Adivasis have been subjugated and have been suppressed in the country for the past 70 years, even after independent India. The Muslims cannot independently, fearlessly walk on the streets today, especially the Dalits and the Adivasis. Their condition is worse. So being a Muslim man, I understood this problem. And my videos in the beginning were focused on Muslim issues. So I made my first video on how Yogi Adityanath is a criminal. Rather, I would call him a criminal, or let's refrain from calling him
because
a criminal.
Because he has been facing so many
absolutely. And the second video I made on how a clerk was killed, and I told people that what is our education for? Where are we heading towards? Where a man is being killed on the pretext that he was supposedly having beef meat in his refrigerator. So I told people, I asked the question, is this the new India? Is this the new norm in India that they kill a person to protect a cow, to protect an animal, kill a human being? And then my video focused on how I will not say Bharat Mata Ki Jai and very sudden Muslim issues. So when I started making videos, I started getting a lot of threat calls. People started telling me, Bharat Mata Ki Jai bolo, say Bharat Mata Ki Jai, say Vande Mataram. So my video focused on these issues, that I will not say Bharat Mata Ki Jai and I will fight for the Muslim identity. And in this whole issue, there was one thing that happened where these people, the BJP IT cell, it was a sinister plan to frame me as an anti-Hindu person, which I am not. All my best friends are Hindu, all my best friends are Christians. I had never even ever thought of being an anti-Hindu person. I am the most secular person on this land right now, I can assure you. But when I was framed as an anti-Hindu person, I realized that I have to bring a shift and I have to prove people wrong. And then I started making videos on policies, started making videos on historical facts, started making videos on how the government policies are affecting people, how government is wasting money, how government is not utilizing our taxes in a proper manner. And then today, when I started working on this, today the anti-Hindu image is there no more. And more than 50% of my crowd are non-Muslim people. Okay. And I'm happy about it. And this is the India that we need, where all the communities come together and lead forward this country.
So,
with a secular ideology.
So what other topics did you choose so you could be able to break that identity?
Absolutely. The first topic that I felt that needs to be touched is that this government is trying to change our history. Is trying to fudge our history, is trying to play with our history, is trying to twist our history and show how we fight with Akbar. After the fight between the war between Akbar and Maharana Pratap was a Hindu-Muslim war. I proved it wrong. If I said the Akbar's commander-in-chief was a Muslim. Akbar's commander-in-chief was a Hindu, Man Singh. And Maharana Pratap's commander-in-chief was a Hindu. So it was not a fight between a Hindu and Muslim. It was a fight for thrones, it was a fight for power. They showed how the fought between Shivaji and Aurangzeb was a Hindu-Muslim war. I debunked it. I said, no, Aurangzeb's commander-in-chief was Raja Jai Singh and Rajput man. And Shivaji's commander-in-chief was Ibrahim Lodi, was Ibrahim Khan. So he was a Muslim man. So Akbar's commander-in-chief is a Hindu man. And Maharana Pratap's commander-in-chief is a Muslim man. Aurangzeb's commander-in-chief is a Hindu man. Shivaji's commander-in-chief is a Muslim man. And how do we say that it was a fight, it was a war between the non-Muslim, between the Hindu and a Muslim? It was a war between two rulers. And I touched various several issues as such. For example, Aurangzeb's army had more than 1 lakh foot army. Out of the 66,000 men were Muslim men. Out of 1,66,000 were Muslim men. So how can we say that Maharana Pratap was anti-Muslim and Maharana Pratap's war was against the Muslims? It was a war for throne, for power. And history has, we've never witnessed in history. There might have been few cases where Muslim Hindu issues might have been there. But the history has been very secular. And unless you read up the history, unless you highlight those facts of the history, you will not be able to change the perception of people. You will not be able to change the narrative that the present government is trying to set. An anti-Muslim narrative, a narrative out of which they want political benefit.
So today in the age of fake news, we see daily basis, even some section of news media, and perhaps some section have also realized that. But you have debunked so many fake news as well. So besides the politics, what do you think that how much the media is responsible, and what do you think as a game changer, as a youth?
I would thank you for asking me this question. How much media is responsible? I would say media, when I was in class 8, 9, 10, in my school days, I was taught that media is the eye and ear of people. Media jo logo ka aankh aur kaan hai. Media jo hume dikhata hai, usse believe karte hai. Media jo hume sunata hai, we believe it. Media is the eye and ear of people. Media is the fourth pillar of democracy. But how far is it true? How far is it practical? Only you know it. Rather, the whole country knows it, right? Media is no more the eye and ear of people. Media is no more the fourth pillar of democracy. We have media paid houses. Media houses have become business houses. You make money from a particular political party, and then you run your episodes, you run your prime times according to what the political party demands and what the political party orders. So media, in the words of Ravish Kumar, for spreading hatred, media is the most responsible unit for spreading hatred amongst people and for dividing people.
Recently, an unfortunate incident, a train accident occurred in Amritsar, in which during the Dashera event on a railway line, reportedly over 70 people were died, and because they were unaware of about the train was coming. And on the very next day, and I would say that in few hours, social media, there was a kind of campaign that the driver was Muslim.
The Muslim man.
Was a Muslim. And that's a kind of hate behind that. So all the non-Muslims were died in that program, in that event of the Dashera. Just after that, Alt News, which is very famous to debunk the fake news in the country now, that has also debunked that news, that the direct driver was not a Muslim. But today we have reached on this point, that
watch.
Do you see that? Is it so easy to spread the fake news?
Absolutely. I was sitting with someone. I was debating. So the other person tells me, "Well, you have only bookish knowledge. You debating with me, it's fine, and it's fine. But you only have bookish knowledge." So I tell the other person, "What else do you want me to read?" So he says, "You don't read for WhatsApp." So that's the culture that we are coming down to. That see, WhatsApp authenticity is regarded much more higher than the book authenticity, right? So a time will come when people will refer WhatsApp and not refer historical facts and artifacts and historical books. People will refer WhatsApp. So a time will come when the JNU University or the Banaras Hindu University will have lesser relevance than the WhatsApp University. So we have to avoid
sometimes do you find very ridiculous this kind of fake news.
Absolutely.
How it is possible just to say that a Muslim driver was driving a train and...
Absolutely. Even if he was a Muslim man, do you really think that he
As an observer on social media, do you think that people in one go believe on
absolutely,
such news?
Absolutely. Such,
what is the reason?
Such that? An environment has been created, an anti-Muslim hatred situation, environment has been created, that any message that you get which is anti-Muslim, you believe it without even checking the facts. You believe it because it is an anti-Muslim message and you forward it.
So when this kind of narrative has been regularly created and a divide on the basis of religious identities between the two communities who have been living peacefully for centuries in this country. So how as a social media campaigner do you think that this narrative of anti-Muslim can be debunked, and how the youth can participate and contribute through social media, how the social media can be effectively used to debunk? What do you
think? So you see, social media of course can be used efficiently, but you need knowledge to debunk the facts. For example, the other day I received a message, a person asking me, why did Aurangzeb kill his three brothers? Was he not a violent man? Was he not a cruel man? So I replied back, I said that why did Ashoka kill 99 of his brothers? So you see, the other person had no answer. So unless you take up, you have to come out of that 140 character of the theater and start reading much more. We need to read. I tell people that today our community and our country is lacking good readers. And only good readers can become good leaders. We stop reading. We prefer watching videos. We prefer watching even the news. You see, we want the news in inshot. You get a news, it writes. It's a 2-minute read.
Yes.
Read it. Must read. Why it's a 2-minute read? It should be an hour read. Read for hours. And the other people, the artist people, they are into a massive research work. And they are into a sinister plan where they are purposely trying to change narrative. And even if they know the fact is wrong, they will purposely spread a fake news. It is not that they know that it's a fake news. They don't know, they're not aware of the fact that it's a fake news. They purposely spread fake news. Social media. Every youth is a social media influencer. But they're not influencing people in the right manner, in the right. You need to channelize your energy. Channelize your influence.
Because as you said, they are not studying or researching more.
Absolutely, they're not studying at all. You have to go beyond your subject, beyond what has been taught in school, beyond what has been taught in your college. You have to become a reader. Unless you're not a good reader, you're not a good leader. And I say every youth should in this time become a leader, leader in itself, for herself.
Talk about something else, like besides your study and making these videos on constitution, policies, governance, and social issues, what else you are doing?
Okay, so can I share one thing which nobody knows until now? So I'm a father of 10 kids.
What?
Yeah, I'm a father of 10 kids. So I have hidden this fact. I've never told anybody about this. Until now, it's the first channel that I'm sharing my experience with. So I'm a father of 10 orphan kids. I have adopted 10 orphan kids. So I had a dream that before I turn 20, I want to be a father of 10, and I've established it. I've achieved it. So today I'm only 19, and 11 kids I have, and they call me Abbaji, which means to be father. They call me father. So and I intend to make them future leaders. I intend to prepare them and train them in a manner and fashion where they become leaders tomorrow.
Okay.
So this is one thing that I want to share.
So where this orphanage is being run?
It's established in Calcutta, my hometown. And it's been established and it's running over there. So this idea came up, when I came into social media activism, I was feeling very lonely. I tried to motivate my brother, my friends to come into this field. And after a year, I realized that people are not going to come into this field. So I wanted more people to join me. I was very sad about the fact that why am I the only one? There are so many intellectuals, so many good readers, so many good teachers, professors. Why are they not raising their voice against the government? Why are they not raising their voice against a particular organization that is spreading hatred for a particular community or for a particular section? So why was I the only person doing this? I tried to find more people and bring them together so that I could form a team and think forward with the same mission. But sadly, I did not find a single person.
When did you establish this orphanage and how this dream came into existence? I'm telling you that only.
So when I failed in finding people like my people, then I thought of taking 10 kids and training them to be future leaders. But no mother would give me their 10 kids and tell me that you take away my kids and train them in the manner you want to train them. So I was in a fix. Then one fine day I was struck with an idea that why not adopt 10 orphan kids because they don't have parents. And then I had a dream of adopting 10 orphan kids, which later turned into an idea. And today it's a reality that I'm a father of 10 orphan kids and 10 orphan kids from my Abaji. Which means
very interesting.
But how it got possible
because you are also studying and...
I tell people that the 3 D's that you need in life, discipline, determination and dedication. The three D's that you have, and of course intention. Because you see, if Mr. Modi's intention was good, the country would have been a totally different country in the 5 years because he promised, whatever he promised, he hasn't been able to fulfill.
And what support did you get from your family and your friends?
My family, the only support that I got from my family is that my family did not resist me from doing it. It's not that my family came forward and said that you do it. The only support that I got is that it did not even say that don't do it. Okay. So this is the support that I got from the family. Because you imagine an 18 years old boy trying to establish an orphanage and telling the world that I want to be a father of 10 kids before I turn 20. Any father or any mother would say that, son, please sit down, it's your time to study. But my parents were supporting it in a manner where they believed in me that this boy can do it. And they saw the spark in me, of course. And my father has supported me by letting me do it. My mother has supported me by letting me do it. And of course, when I was into social media activism, my parents were supportive. Of course,
so
imagine.
Of course, you're some good friends must have been helping you in this noble cause.
Nobody known to me has helped me in this. Very few people have helped me, and people who have helped me have now become known to me. So I started off alone, and now today I have a team of 50-60 people and very good people. For example, I have a person, Yusuf Bhai. I call him Yusuf Bhai. He's a 4th-stage cancer survivor. And he's survived the last-stage cancer, and he's dedicated his whole life to the Umeed orphanage that I've established. He says, for the rest of my life, is for the orphanage that he set up. I have a person like Razala ma'am. I call her ma'am. She's in her 60s. And she says, for the rest of my life, without taking a single penny, she's handling the whole of orphanage. Because at the end, I lack experience, and I want experienced people. And the best part of it is that they are in 40s, Mr. Yusuf is in 40s, Mrs. Razala is in her 60s. And she's accepted the fact that an 18-year-old boy, an 18-year-old boy can lead us. And they consider me to be their leaders. That's the best part. That's the beauty of it. So now it's running orphanage, running, and people around me. And I have a huge team of more than 60 people, dedicated people who are working for the orphanage. Even today, if I die or if I forget the fact that I've ever
taking care of all the things, their study, everything.
I would rather say that nobody is aware of the fact that there is an orphanage I've set up. But if anybody comes and visits my orphanage, they would surely be impressed, and I can assure you the fact that the whole country does not have the setup that I have in the orphanage. Nowhere in the country you can find such a setup.
Will you be continuing your social media videos?
Of course, I will be continuing till the time I can. Social media, but activism will continue, of course, to the last breath of mine. I tell people, when people ask me that, are you scared? Of course, I am scared, but I tell people that 2 days of my life are. घर से की सोच के निकलता हूँ कि आज मैं सब. And this is the exact. I believe every youth of the country should have the exact dialogue. And Iqbal had said, "Ain jawa marta, hab koi o bebaqi." The constitution of the young man is fearlessness and truthfulness. And these are two characters characteristics that is missing in the today's youth. You have to be truthful, you have to be fearless. I ask the youth to be truthful and fearless.
Thank you very much, Wali Rahman, for coming with us for this special show. And here, as you have watched that Wali Rahmani with so many dreams, very good messages he has given to the youth of the country. And you can watch us, you can subscribe our YouTube channel, Caravan Daily, and Facebook and Twitter.